Good evening, and welcome to Big Springs Baptist Church. At this time, we will hear from Mike Green.
I was lost, but you knew where to find me. I was hungry, you were bread for my soul. I was thirsty, and you gave living water. You were my shelter when I had no place to go. That's why sometimes I just want to praise you. Sometimes just to speak your name. Sometimes I just want to thank you without asking you for a thing. Sometimes I lift my hands to you. Sometimes all I do is cry. Everything that I have, I owe to you, Lord, and Calvary's the reason why. When I think of all the love that you have given me, and I think of the sacrifice that you made for me, all these trials and troubles here on this old earth, they just seem like nothing when they're compared to dark Calvary. That's why sometimes I just want to praise you. Sometimes just to speak your name. Sometimes I just want to thank you without asking you for a thing. Sometimes I lift my hands to you. Sometimes all I do is cry. Everything that I have, I owe to you, Lord, and Calvary's the reason why. Lord, and Calvary's the reason why.
Thank you, Mike. What a message, and that's hard to do, singing without music. So he did an outstanding job. If everyone would get their hymn books, we're going to turn to page 139 and stand as we sing At the Cross, number 139.
At the cross, evening. And welcome home to Big Springs Baptist Church. It is so good to see all of you. We are so glad you're here to worship the Lord with us. And we are excited about what he has for us tonight. And we've been going through the Easter story, the last 24 hours of Jesus' earthly ministry. And we have come to the cross. And of course, this and the resurrection are the climax. Oh, I shouldn't have told you resurrection. I'm giving away the story on Sunday. You still got to come back on Sunday to find out what happens. I did not mean to do that. But anyway, the cross. We've come to the cross. And I am so thrilled about that. Like we said last night, there's so much you could look at there. And Jim's going to do this, and I may do the same thing. Sometimes you got to focus in on one moment there just to get a sense of that. And I'm looking forward to what we're going to hear tonight. Just to remind you, of course, tomorrow night we'll be having I'll be preaching about the last 3 hours of the cross. Saturday, don't forget, if you ordered a Boston butt, pick them up. They want you to come pick them up, because they're going to be, while we're in here tomorrow night, they're going to be out there cooking them. They're going to be getting everything ready, so they got to get started tomorrow night. They'll be ready Saturday morning. The Easter egg hunt is at 10 o'clock on Saturday morning. Sunday, of course, is our Easter service. We all know it starts at 6:30, and it'll be over at 10. So just make it simple on yourself. Be here at 6:30, and you get to go home at 10 o'clock. But don't forget your Easter flowers. Flowers or whatever flowers you have, you can bring them and put them in the cross there, and that'll be absolutely wonderful. So looking forward to all those things, but we are so glad that you're here tonight, and so looking forward to Preacher Jim bringing the word for us. We're going to pray, and of course we're going to be praying for Jim. We're going to be praying that the Lord will do a work in all of our lives during this time. And so I'm going to ask, I think everybody, well, not everybody, we are so glad to have, we are just glad to have, you can't say this most of the time during church, right? Because you always leave somebody out. Brother Porky, Betty, we are so glad to have you here tonight. We are thrilled to have you. Yes. So if you haven't been here, just so you know, we begin our prayer time, I'm directing our prayer a little bit, just giving you some things to think about in prayer. And so I'll say something and you pray about it while Reba plays. So I'm going to ask Reba to go ahead and pray as we play, as we begin in prayer. The Apostle Paul told the church at Corinth, "I have determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. This is the message. This is the story. This is the bad news of the good news that makes the gospel so sweet, that Jesus bore our sins on Calvary's tree." And right now, let's pray for Preacher Jim. Let's pray that as he gets ready to bring the word, that he'll be empowered by the Holy Spirit, that the words that he speaks will be driven deep into our heart, and that the scripture truths will come alive to us. Let's pray for Preacher Jim right now. I think it's appropriate tonight that we ask the Lord to give us a heart for the lost. That as we consider the message of Easter, this was the message that was meant to be told. We're going to hear on Sunday how the women are told, go tell his disciples. How the disciples are told to go tell all the world. This is the message that needs to be told. But it takes a heart for the lost to be willing to share. So let's ask that the Lord would give all of us a heart for those who are lost, whoever they are, wherever they are. Let's pray about that right now. Well, we want a heart for the lost. But even more specifically, I want us to pray for somebody. Surely all of us know a name. We all know somebody who needs the Lord. Even if you don't know their name, maybe it's just somebody you saw at Ingles or somebody you saw at the gas station, but you're pretty sure that person has no idea who Jesus is. Never come by repentance and faith to Him. I want you to pray right now for that person by their name and ask that the Lord would save them, that He would use you or me or somebody. There's surely somebody they would listen to hear the good news of the gospel. Let's pray for that person by name right now. Our Father, the words that Reba are playing in music, sweet hour of prayer, how true that is. What a privilege prayer is that we can come, and we can come boldly before your throne of grace. Not like the old covenant where they were told to stay away, to not come near, stand back. But now we are invited to come near, to draw near to you and to lift up our prayers and the burdens of our heart and cast them, our cares, before your feet, knowing that you care for us. We thank you for that. And we thank you for Preacher Jim and Carol. Lord, we ask that you would indeed endue him with your power, that he might preach your word, that we might hear what we need to hear tonight. Maybe not what we want to hear. Maybe not things that would tickle our ears, but what we need to hear tonight. And Lord, we do pray for the lost in general, but also the names that were called out, the people that were envisioned, the lives that need to be touched. Lord, we ask that you would use us as this church or use another church. Lord, that you would somehow reach them. They would come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior, especially during this time, the celebration of the resurrection. We ask you to do this, we pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Our next hymn is number 290, I Am Thine, O Lord. If you would stand as we sing number 290.
Yeah.
this time we're going to hear from Mike Green again.
I was in the crowd the day that Jesus died. As he hung upon the cross, his mother cried. I saw the crown of thorns he wore, the stripes upon his back. The water and the blood ran out, and then the skies turned black. My mind was filled with anger. My heart was filled with shame. This man brought only healing, and who could bring him pain? Why does it seem the strong always victimize the weak? Suddenly I found myself standing to my feet, and I cried, who nailed it there, this child of peace and mercy. Who nailed it there, gonna face me like a man? Who nailed it there? Then the crowd began to mock me. I cried, oh my God, I just don't understand. Children, and I do the best I can. How can I have killed him? There must be someone else. There's got to be an answer. I just can't blame myself. Who nailed him there? This child of peace and mercy. Who nailed him there? Come and face me like a nailed him there. Then the crowd began to mock me. I cried, oh my God, I just don't understand. And I turned and saw the hammer in my hand. I nailed him there, this child of peace and mercy. I nailed him there. I am the guilty man. I nailed him there with my sins and my transgressions. I cried, oh my God, now I understand. When I turned and saw the hammer in my hand.
We all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But there's one way to forgive, get forgiven. God died on the cross for us. You come to the altar and pray and ask for forgiveness, and he will forgive you. Surely this man was a son of God. Thank you so much, Mike. I don't know that we need to introduce our speaker tonight. I think there's three things I can tell you. Number one, Jim and I are exactly the same in this. We both married way out of our league.
Amen.
That's what I thought. So. I'll tell you that to me, Jim has been, and Carol both, and you can't say one without the other, really, has been nothing but a blessing. There's no other word to say it. They have been just a blessing to me and to my family. Just a friend, a confidant, an encourager, just somebody who's been nothing but just a blessing to my life. But I do want to tell you something about you, and many of you probably know this, but maybe not all. And I was reminded about this when Joe Edwards passed away. When I was coming here to, I wasn't coming yet. I came to Big Springs and I preached a secret sermon that nobody knew who I was, and just came and, you know, Eddie Stepp was gone one Sunday and I just came and filled in just to see how things went. And after that, Linda Bridges and the search committee, Glenn was on that search committee. Marion was, and Catherine Horn was, and and Sybil Hauser was, and so they gave me three phone numbers, and the first person that I need to call these people, and it was Jim Richardson, Joe Edwards, and Eddie Stepp. And Jim was the very first one I called, and I said, "Tell me about Big Springs," and what he said was, "This is the best church he ever pastored." That's what he said. He also pointed a few of you out by name, and so I wrote those names down. But no, I'm just kidding you. That's what he said. He said this was the best church he ever pastored. And I think that is a testament to him and to you as well. Jim, come and share with us, please.
I remember saying those very words when I retired, that really didn't work out, you know, saying that to these people when I thought was my last Sunday here. I told them that I had been in some big churches, I had been in some city churches, I had been here, there, and yon, but your fellowship and your love of me and my wife, and just the joy of being able to feel the fellowship. You know, a lot of churches, they have problems. You don't hear about it and know about it until you're about 2 months in. I kept waiting for the other shoe to drop, and it never dropped. It never dropped. So I am a great believer in this church. I brag about this church all the time. So does my wife. We are so glad in our journey of life that we found you. And you have been a blessing to us, and you continue to be a blessing to us. And we only want to be a blessing to you. And so we just look forward to the future. I just hope I can do what I'm doing for quite a while. We take it just a day at a time, you know, and then we're still able to do, so we just keep cranking along, hoping for the best. Where we are talking about the cross, and we've finally gotten to the cross now, to the crucifixion. And I want to read some scripture here. I'm going to be talking about the repentant thief. This is only found in the Gospel of Luke. And I want you to turn to Luke chapter 23. And start with 33. Luke 23. 33, and we're going to be reading through verse 43. This is when he comes to the cross. He is there, and the scripture reads, "When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and the other on the left. But Jesus was saying, 'Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are, do not know what they are doing.' And they cast lots, dividing up garments among themselves. And the people stood by, looking on. And even the rulers were sneering at him, saying, 'He saved others. Let him save himself, if this be, this is the Christ of God, his chosen one. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming up to him, offering him sour wine, and saying, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. Now there was also an inscription above him, this is the king of the Jews. And one of the criminals who was hanging there was hurling abuse at him, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other answered and rebuked him, saying, do you not even fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he was saying, Jesus, remember me. Just remember me when you come into your kingdom. And he said to him, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Let's bow together. Father, we're thankful for your word. We're thankful, Lord, that it is sharper than any two-edged sword that can cut to the heart, our hearts. We're thankful, Lord, that you were willing to go to that cruel cross. We're thankful, Lord, that there was a plan from the foundations of the world that you would come desiring to save the lost and to win the world. And Father, we're a part of that plan. We're your church. We pray, Lord, as Paul said earlier, that you would give us a renewed dedication to reach out to the lost, to encourage those that need to be encouraged, to invite those that need to be invited. Lord, that we can have a burden on our hearts. This world so needs the Spirit of the Lord within its hearts. Now, this is a time of great turmoil, a time of challenge, a time, Lord, when people need the Lord more than they ever have. May we be instruments, Lord, to be able to win those that don't know you. And we can be instruments of encouragement to those that are downtrodden. We can be the ones, Lord, that make the difference for the kingdom of God. Lord, go with us during this time. These things we ask in thy name. Amen. We come to the cross here. And I want to reiterate a little bit what was said last night about the cross. You know, sometimes we romanticize it. We don't think of the depths of it and the tragedy of it and the cruelty of it, the longevity of the cross, the hours of pain and suffering. We take that cross and we print it on Bibles in gold, and women wear chains and men and with a cross. There are pictures of Jesus and it seems like he's sleeping. He wasn't sleeping, friend. Hour after hour, he was half dead when he got on the cross. He must have been a person of tremendous physical strength to be able to withstand that as long as he. And he did it for you and I. I want to impress that upon you. I think about that often myself. Back a number of years ago the Roman Empire, there was a slave revolt led by a man named Spartacus. You remember there was a movie back in the 50s, Kirk Douglas, and he was the leader of this slave revolt. And when he was captured and they were finally defeated after fighting the Romans for several years, there were 6,000 crosses set up all over the Roman Empire. And 6,000 of those people they spared them only for the reason to put their own crosses to intimidate those people in the Roman Empire. This is what happens to people that defy Rome. It was a slow death, an agonizing death, in public, to humiliate someone, to torture someone, It was a shameful death. It was a death that was reserved for criminals and seditionists and terrible people. And here was the Son of God that suffered that for us. And we need to realize that. We find this account of the repentant thief only in the Gospel of Luke. But my friends, it is an account rich in meaning. During the Passion of Jesus, he fulfilled three great roles in his life, that of prophet, priest, and king. He was a prophet when he said, "Daughters of," as he was on his way to the cross, and they were weeping as he walked by with the cross on his shoulder. He said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but for yourselves, for the days are coming when great judgment will come on the earth." He was a prophet. Then he was a priest. When he got up on the cross, and we said it tonight, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He was in the role of a priest. He was interceding for these people that were doing this terrible thing to him. Then he was in the role of a king when he said to this repentant thief, "This day thou shalt be with me in paradise." How differently the same circumstances work on different natures. One thief on one side taunts him, accuses him, threatens him, curses him. And on the other side, the repentant thief, he seeks forgiveness, cleansing, and help. The reactions were totally opposite of the same situation. This poor penitent thief, I have the idea, Paul, he was a young man, maybe in his mid-20s or so, perhaps fighting under some false messiah. And here at the very end of his life, he saw this repentant thief just before he died, that what this was the real messiah. And amidst the sea of criticism and rebuke and hatred, this was the only one that was speaking words of support and comfort to Jesus. Ironic it is that the moment this dying thief had a clearer view of faith in Jesus coming than any of the disciples had, they weren't even there. They were in hiding. They were afraid. They were denying they even knew him. We may call him, in one sense, the only disciple that Christ had at that time. He was the only human being there at the cross who completely believed that Jesus was who he said he was. So he had these two thieves on either side of Jesus. One joining in with the scribes and the Pharisees to disbelieve the claims of Jesus. The one on the other side sharing his testimony of faith. The thief on the left joins with the taunts of the rulers and the soldiers. "What kind of Messiah are you? Get the three of us out of this." His only interest was self-preservation. Now this repentant thief, he takes the opposite side. This is a just man. He doesn't deserve this. This is the way it is for every man. The gospel is preached to every man. There's no middle ground. There's no halfway. "Well, I sort of believe." You don't sort of believe, you don't have belief enough to accept him as Lord and Savior. There's no middle ground. It's either yes or no. So we look at the scene. And these two thieves reacting so differently to this situation. All three of them were being executed for the same crime. Insurrection. Insurrection. The charge was the same, plotting to overthrow the power of Rome. The penitent thief knew that he was guilty of that charge. And he knew that Jesus wasn't. What did he say? "We deserve what we're getting. We have lived evil lives. But this man, he doesn't deserve this at all." Why was his attitude different? Well, we really don't know, but perhaps there's some ideas here. Maybe he had some prior knowledge of Jesus. Maybe he had been in some of the vast crowds. Jesus was the rock star of that day. Thousands of people came to hear him. Maybe some were believers and wanted to be a part of his kingdom. Maybe some people were just curious to hear what this was all about. Maybe he had some prior knowledge. Maybe there was some inkling that Jesus was getting through to him. Maybe he had that prior knowledge. Secondly, maybe he watched closely the conduct of Jesus as he went to the cross. As the other thief was cursing and mad and upset, he saw Jesus, how composed he was, how there seemed to be a peaceful nature about him deep within. So maybe he had seen that. Maybe thirdly, the Holy Spirit was working on his life. You know, the Holy Spirit doesn't start working with us until we're not alive anymore. You know, maybe the Holy Spirit was working on his life. So what does he say to Jesus? Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. Remember me. Remember what I said. This is the one last claim on his life, my friends. His hands were empty. There was no life to live for Jesus. There was no chance for him to be a disciple. There was no chance for him to give to the early church. There was no chance for him to be useful to Jesus. He was about to die. He had nothing to give. Nothing. He was laying hold of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. He prayed that Jesus would remember his repentance, remember his confession, remember his faith, and forgive him and make him a part of that kingdom. When you come, remember me. Just remember me. I will stand far off. I'm not worthy of your kingdom, but just remember me. Remember you? What did Jesus say? You will be with me. You'll be close by my side. This day, you will be with me in paradise. Folks, this argues against soul sleep. You know, there's some people who believe in soul sleep. When we die, we're in the ground and we're twiddling in our thumbs maybe for 1,000 years till Jesus decides to come back. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. What does that mean? Exactly what it says. When you close your eyes on this earth, you open them in heaven, just like that, just like that. We won't be any waiting around. Now, I don't understand how all that works out in Jesus coming back, you know, and all. I just know what the scripture says. To be absent from your body, when you draw your last breath, you'll breathe your next breath in heaven. I believe that with all my heart. Now, there's several lessons here that I want to share with you tonight. Number one, the brevity with which a great spiritual revolution may be wrought in the human mind. Some people think, well, I've got to go and read my Bible for a year. I've got to go talk to the preacher for about 6 months. I've got to do this. I got to get ready and all that. And that may be the road some people travel. But it can happen in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. The brevity that this thing can turn around. And that gives us great hope for people. I know you've got people on your prayer list, people you wish were in this church and you wish were Christians, and maybe it's been weeks, months, years, and there's been no movement, no anything, and sometimes you seem to want to kind of give up. Don't do it. You never know when God is going to speak. You never know when the truth is going to come into that person's heart. That can happen quickly. Hours before this event on Calvary, this criminal, this thief, the repentant thief, was a hardened criminal. He had lived a life of murderous violence. After seeing Jesus suffer, he was remade. He was a changed man. Death was coming. Sometimes people say, well, a drowning man will catch on to anything that protrudes from the bank. I don't know whether that's so or not. But he was thinking, this is my last hope. Life can sometimes best be seen in the light of death. And in this particular moment, suddenly his heart opened up to it all. Many things can change a person's heart quickly. It can be imminent peril. It can be a great emergency. It can be a loss in their life. It can be a baby born. It can be any number of things where people, you think their hearts are hard as stone, and they're not. They're not. I've seen it happen in my own ministry. I remember in my first church, Lord of Mercy, I was 27 when I went to that church. Carol was 23. What were they thinking? First Baptist Church, Tryon. And I remember there's a fellow that came to me and said, I want you to visit somebody. And I said, who? He said, well, his name's Red Lockhart. I said, okay, I don't know him. Well, someone got the word that someone had told me as the preacher to go visit Red Lockhart. And he came to me. He said, preacher, don't you go see that man. He'll cut you with his knife. Thanks for the encouragement, you know. I said, well, I'm going to go anyway. Now, I took a big deacon with me. You know, I mean, the biggest deacon I can find. Brother, we're going. Come on, you know. So, Gene Jones, you know exactly who I'm talking about, Carol. We went to see Red Lockhart. Well, he was this big old guy. I bet he weighed 240 pounds, 6'4", you know. And he had red hair, and I just said he had mentioned to someone he might go to church, you know. And so I was just returning what his interest, you know. And he was kind of a gruff guy. Yeah, I might go do it. I don't know, preacher. Appreciate you coming by, you know. Next Sunday, he was in the pew out there. And next Sunday, he was in the pew again. Next Sunday, he was in the pew. I don't even know what I preached on. It may not even matter what I preached on. Here he came down the aisle with tears going down his cheeks. The whole church was stirred. It was an amazing thing. He became the most wonderful Christian. He never cut me with his knife. Don't give up on anybody. Sometimes it can be a powerful sermon. Sometimes a sudden inspiration from God that has nothing to do with you. Sometimes it's a brilliant flash of remembrance. Sometimes it's a realization that strikes their hearts. Sometimes it's a conviction. The thing is, don't ever give up on anybody. Don't. There's a great drawing power in the cross of Christ. He can do it. And as we pray and as we love people, we invite people, we continue to be an example to them. As we continue to do that, the scripture says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And we need to believe that and trust that it can happen. Well, this thief, he sees his sin. And somehow, in some way, he sees the holiness of Jesus. He has just moments to live. How strange the contrast between the opening of that day and the close of that day. The morning of that day and the night of that day. It's never too late to repent. Repentance, when it is real, is never ineffectual. But that repentance, my friends, listen, is good early. Early, because I know this thief was one to the Lord. I know that thief was in heaven with Jesus that day. But you know that he had a boatload of regrets. I've wasted my life on foolish things. And I think I've heard that from some people that have found the Lord late, and I've known too, that that's the one thing that hits them. Why did it take me so long? What was I thinking? How wrong I was. Some people have asked me, do I believe in deathbed confessions? Yes, I've heard a few. But the tragedy of it all, it's a life wasted that could have been used for the service of Christ. Well, number one that we hear is great spiritual decisions can be made quickly. Number two, it's never too late to repent. You only can't repent when you die. Then it's too late. The third thing is the one that is important to me. The soldiers, the scribes and the Pharisees, the unrepentant thief, the one on the other side that never repented. What blocked them from hearing Christ? Those great scholars and the ones from the Sanhedrin and all those ones that had all that learning and the others around the cross that felt that they were righteous people. What blocked them from hearing Christ? Pride. Pride. Their knowledge. Their learning. Their education. Their self-sufficiency. Sin plus self-righteousness is an insurmountable barrier to the Holy Spirit of God. All sin separates from God, but the thing that makes the separation permanent is not the sin, but the ignorance of the sin. The ignorance of the sin. Look at the scribes and Pharisees. Oh, they were religious men in their own way. Wise men, maybe decent men, respectable men. And look at this poor thief caught among the caves and dens, red-handed with blood on his sword and guilt in his heart. And the scribes could look at Jesus and see nothing. And the thief looked at him and saw everything. Everything. No transgression shuts a man out of the mercy of God. Sin, which belongs to all of us, makes us subjects of mercy. It is pride, self-righteousness, trust in ourselves, and ignorance of our own sin that bars the gates. That's what does it. So we ought to be able to say, all of us here tonight, I am nothing. He is everything. I bring myself and my emptiness into His great fullness. We can all say, I am a sinful man, Lord. All punishment that comes to me, I richly deserve. But this man, Jesus, He is pure and righteous. We can all say, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Remember me. That is all. That is all. We're all that way. Paul Scott is a sinner saved by grace. Dustin Hammett is a sinner saved by grace. Stephen Brackeen is a sinner saved by grace. Jamie Bridges is a sinner saved by grace. Jim Richardson, he's his chief. Is that not what the Apostle Paul said that wrote most of the New Testament? I am the chief of sinners. The more you realize your sin, the closer you get to God. The closer you get to Him. So help us as we get close to God to realize what a wonderful gift it is to know you're saved and to know you're going to heaven and to know that your sins have been forgiven. And try to impart that to other people. One day we're going to go to heaven. And you know what I think the Lord's going to ask us, folks? How many did you bring with you? How many did you bring with you? Because of your influence, your words, your testimony, your witness, your friendship, your prayers. How many did you bring with you? I feel that I want to continue to preach and teach and be a part of the church because I want to keep bringing people. I don't want to stop doing that. I want to do that as long as there's breath in my body. I want to do that. I want to think tonight when we have the invitation. I think it ought to have two parts of it. Number one, you can do this in your
pew, but if you want to come down, you can make that commitment to the pastor here. That you want to have a burden for people. That the Lord will put a burden on your heart. And you want that, so you'll pray for them, invite them to church, befriend them, send them cards, letters. We're doing the Shaw ministry. And we're reaching out now to folks that aren't part of this church. Just had a good visit, chance to witness to a lady yesterday that has cancer. And secondly, we want to pray that the Lord would take anything in our hearts that is prideful and help us to realize that all goodness comes from the Lord. So if you have a decision to make or just a commitment, I want to reach more people. I want to have a burden. I want to be a humble Christian. I don't want to feel there's anything good in me except the Lord. That's my challenge as we extend the invitation and I turn the service over to Paul. Paul.
If you would take your hymnal, turn to hymn number 300, Without Him. Let's all stand as we sing. Hymn number 300. This will be a hymn of invitation. You can come as we sing. As Jim said, you can stay right where you are, or you can come up here to the front, whatever you wish. Hymn number 300, Without Him. Stop the stream real quick.